Well, for condos. Oh, it's really starting. I got to start thinking now. Oh my God. Smell the burning? I quit. Aloha and welcome to another edition of Condo Insider, Hawaii's show about association living. Whether you're a board member or an owner, you should find interest in many of the topics we have to help make your experience in your association better. Anyway, one thing that I would tell you about is that tomorrow is an important day. It's called first decking at our legislature. And what that means is the bill hasn't gotten through all of the committees, it's dead. So of the 4,000 to 5,000 bills that were introduced this year, probably 200 or 300 remain as of tomorrow, making my job a lot easier. But it's also annual meeting season for associations, particularly condos. And so I've invited as our guest today, Scott Shirley, Director of Training of Associa, to talk about annual meetings and kind of the things we don't really ever talk about annual meeting, the most common questions. But Scott, welcome back to the show.
Well, thank you for cornering me again onto the show.
Yeah, and tell me what you've been up to. And I understand you have a new job since I
new
see a
job,
new title.
Yeah, I've been appointed Director of Training for Associa Hawaii, helped the community managers and such understand the statutes, the rules, the laws. We've hit the ground running already talking about emotional support animals, which seems to be still an issue for some reason, but looking forward to doing a lot of training. Good people over there.
Well, I have an emotional support wife, and I'm not sure that's quite the same thing, but...
Well, she's the same emotional support wife that wouldn't let you have your emotional support miniature elephant, so she's good.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, all kidding aside, it is time for annual meetings for condo associations.
Yep.
Where does an annual meeting come from? Why do they have an annual meeting?
Well, actually, by statute, you are supposed to have an annual meeting. In this, we call it an annual meeting, but in my opinion, the real name is it's the owner's meeting, because it's a meeting of all the owners with the board and going over everything that happened, good or bad, over the last year and voting on issues and things like that. It's, in my opinion, one of the most important meetings of the association.
And I know we're going to talk about some technical aspects of it, but I want to tell everybody that the things we talk about for the annual meeting also would apply to a special meeting of homeowners.
Yes.
So we talk about some technical laws and requirements. It also applies to special meetings of the homeowners, because sometime during the years, boards will call a special meeting of the homeowners for a special mm-hmm. purpose. And so what we're talking about will apply to that as well. So you go into the meeting, they give you an agenda. Where does the agenda come from?
Oh, it's just made up. No. The agenda, well, it would indicate in the bylaws or the governing documents the way the meeting is supposed to be run. If it's not a new project, then you're also going to have old business and new business, whatever was carried over from the last annual meeting. And, of course, very important to vote on everything that the board did over the last year, approving of everything that they had done.
Well, I know that, just for clarification, that the bylaws do require the order of business.
Mm-hmm.
So when you see that it says call the meeting to order, proof of notice, quorum, that's specified in the bylaws. So boards really don't have a choice. That's the order of business. Yeah. Although Robert's Rules does provide for ways to amend the agenda, but without an amendment, proper amendment from the floor, the order of business will always be done in that order because
yep.
it's specified in the bylaws. And what would you say the major reasons you have annual meetings?
Well, annual meetings are very important so that the owners can know what was going on during the course of the year. They may be reading the minutes or not, but it's for also their involvement in what's going on in the association. It is the owners' meeting. It is their meeting. They can actually make motions from the floor. That's not even on the agenda at that particular time. So, but you have certain things that have to be done. You might have an IRS rollover to do, or appointing the auditor, voting on certain things that require a percentage of the ownership to vote on that's beyond what the board could normally vote on. And it's a very important meeting to have that.
Well, let's talk about some of the misunderstood things. Now, I think we'll do this in kind of a logical order from my perspective. So the board knows that it has to have an annual meeting, both by statute and by their governing documents. And so they want to call the annual meeting. And, of course, they need to have a quorum of 50% of the owners by person or by proxy. So the first step, as I understand it, is they're going to want to have proxies because absentee owners, people can't make it. And certainly proxies are a valid tool. They're used in corporations to make sure that owners can be represented whether they can be there in person or not. Mm-hmm. The first notice is the notice to solicit proxies. Is that right?
Yes.
And you remember what that's about?
Well, the notice to solicit proxies, if the board itself is going to solicit proxies, they have to follow a certain rule. You probably know it better than I even know it, that it has to be on 8.5 by 11 paper, and why you're soliciting the proxies, what do you want to use it for, and things like that. And that has to go out in advance.
Yeah, and because I probably asked it in a confusing way, I'm going to kind of readdress this issue. The proxy form itself is established by law. If
yes.
the board wants to use a proxy, it's established by law. You must have the four boxes.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll go back to the four boxes later in our discussion. And because the board has decided to solicit proxies, they must give the owners the right to include in the proxy solicitation an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper that would say why maybe they should get the proxy instead of the board.
Exactly.
And so that has to be included in the same mailing as the proxy. And that's on the statute. And that has to be done 30 days before the notice of the annual meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about this and you back that up, the statute requires a minimum 14 days notice of an annual meeting.
Yes.
So if you have to give 30 days notice in the proxies, you're at 45 days. When you assume mailing time and everything else, most annual meetings, the solicitation begins about 75 days before the annual meeting, beginning with a notice at the property saying the board is going to solicit proxies. They have to use that form with the four boxes ultimately when the proxies go out, and saying to owners that if you want to solicit proxies or you want to say something, it doesn't have to be for the board. You may solicit because you don't want to have a bylaw amendment approved.
Yep.
You have a right to include at no cost in the annual association mailing an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper.
That's right.
Because I remember the old days where before the statute was changed 2 or 3 years ago, it used to say 100 words.
100 words.
And I remember often owners, because there'd be this political fight, and they'd say, well, does the date February 9th count as one word or two words? And does the telephone number, does the area code count as a word plus the number a word? Because they'd get so manini on this whole thing, on the 100 words. That's really 102 words. You can't mail it out. That the industry went and had the law changed to read one side of an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper.
And now the print type can be two-point print in order to fit everything right on there. You can't read it, but it can be.
Yeah, or you can have cartoons or photographs or whatever you want on an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper.
Political but cartoons, yes.
It's interesting, the dynamic history to this is that why is it an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper? Well, do you want to have an owner submitting 3,000 sheets of paper with their legal interpretation and all these documents they got off the internet as a major expense to the association?
Yes.
So they pretty much drew a line that said that an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper as of 2 or 3 years ago. Once they do that, then the annual meeting notice goes out minimum 14 days, but usually around 30 days in advance, because
mm-hmm.
you have people going to the mainland or the addresses to the mainland, and when they get the official proxy, and then they get to submit that and choose who they want to have it. So anyway, let's talk about the proxy for a second. I've already said that it is the four boxes is mandated by law.
Yep.
And so if an owner takes a piece of toilet paper and writes a proxy, is it valid?
If all the material that needs to be on that piece of toilet paper, if we're supposing that, is there and signed, I would imagine it'd still be, it's like many, many years back when I took my real estate exam through John Stapleton, he used to wave his arm around and say you could write a contract on a napkin on the hood of a car, which is true. You didn't have to use a standardized form.
Yeah, that's an important point, because if an owner put the minimum information, that is the date, their name and their signature and their unit number, and saying I'm given Scott Shirley my proxy for the annual meeting of ABC Association on March 10th, 2017, and signed it, the board would have to accept that, because it's not their right to prohibit a person's free will to choose who they want to represent them. But when the board solicits proxies, because you have the quorum only, the board majority, the board equal, these other options, if the board proxy, the one the association mails, must include those four items.
Yes.
And those four items are?
For quorum purposes only. To be given to an individual, which they would write their name into that individual, to be given to the board as a whole, and my least favorite is to be given to the board equally.
Explain the four differences.
Well, of course, quorum is, and I always recommend people, even if they're going to attend the meeting, send that proxy form in for quorum purposes only. You don't know if you're going to get sick, have an accident, and then suddenly not be able to make it to the meeting, and then because you didn't make it, there wasn't a quorum. At least they have a proxy that says for quorum purposes only, so that they can at least use that to establish a quorum. Then the other box is, and I probably don't even have these in order, but the other box is I give my proxy to, and then you would indicate who you're giving your proxy to. And you can give it to anybody, friend, relative, guy on the corner that you just met standing waiting for the walk sign and all that kind of stuff. Then you can give it to the board where the board uses it equally, or as a whole, they all decide together, this is where we're going to put the votes, let's say, on the proxy. And then the last one is to be divided equally among the board members. So if you have a 1% ownership that and seven board members, it's going to be split between those seven board members. So you're breaking that percentage down to even a smaller percentage for each board member.
Yeah, and to drill down on that, what people have to understand, if you had a seven-member board in your example, and only five board members were present, then you would take that percentage of ownership, the 1% hypothetically that you owned, and divide it by five, and each owner would be voting 0.2% or one-fifth of your percentage of ownership. The board majority is also common. Would mean of those five board members there, three of the two, or the majority, would then say, I want that whole 1% voted this way.
Yeah, exactly.
And those are the four choices that are mandated by law, again, recognizing that an owner could write on a piece of toilet paper with all the necessary information, I give my proxy to the board majority, or I give it to Scott Shirley, or I give my proxy for quorum only, and that would still be an acceptable and valid proxy.
I think the other important thing to remember, too, say I gave my proxy to you. That doesn't mean I can't go to the annual meeting.
Right.
You can still vote my proxy, and I can just be sitting in the audience watching to make sure you vote the way I wanted you to vote or something to that effect.
As an owner, you have a right to attend a meeting, but you can still give someone your authority to vote and do a proxy at the annual meeting. Okay, this is quite interesting, probably more to others than you and I who've done this
many times.
Too many times. We're going to take a short break from Condo Insider, and we'll be right back.
Hello, I'm Marianne Sasaki. Welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii, where some of the most interesting conversations in Honolulu go on. I have a show on Wednesdays from 1 to 2 called Life in the Law, where we discuss legal issues, politics, governmental topics, and a whole host of issues. I hope you'll join me.
Hello, this is Martin Despang. I want to get you get excited about my new show, which is Humane Architecture for Hawaii and Beyond. We're going to broadcast on Tuesdays, 5 p.m. here on ThinkTech Hawaii.
Aloha kākou. I'm Marcia Joyner, inviting you to navigate the journey with us. We are here every Wednesday morning at 11 a.m., and we really want you to be with us, where we look at the options and choices of end-of-life care. Aloha.
Welcome back to Condo Insider. We're going through annual meeting tips of some of the most misunderstood issues at common or at annual meetings. We've already discussed the fact to have an annual meeting, you have to give notice, and certain owners have rights to send in an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper with their request for your proxy by statute to balance the playing field. And once the call of the meeting is made, people go and they can be represented by person or by proxy, and Scott has told us that you can still give your proxy and go to the annual meeting. So now you're in the annual meeting, and we're going to go through this order of business, which is prescribed in the bylaws. Mm-hmm. But probably the number one thing that's going to happen at the meeting, you're going to elect directors.
Yes.
And often they're usually elected by what we call a percentage of common interest. So every unit has a different value based on maybe its size or whatever the developer chose its rationale. But you might have a 1% ownership interest or a 1.2% ownership. You're voting that number. You're not voting like one for your unit.
Yeah, exactly.
You're voting this percentage of common interest. And bylaws will have differences. They'll either say you're voting by straight voting or by cumulative voting. What's the difference?
Well, straight voting is, let's just say, for example, you have two positions coming open that are going to be elected on, and you have three people running. That means on the ballot, whoever has the proxy or whoever is voting will mark one to one name and one to another name, and then, of course, one name is going to be left blank because they only have two votes because there's only two positions available. That's just straight regular voting. Cumulative voting, however, which I don't personally particularly care for because it's open for abuse, in my opinion, is you have two positions open, three people running, and instead of taking one vote to one name, one vote to another name, you can apply all your votes to just one name. And that's what they mean by cumulative voting, and that sometimes can cause some problems.
Yeah, even the National Association of Parliamentarians doesn't recommend cumulative voting, but the idea behind it is to give minority interests a way to stack mm-hmm. their votes to get representation. Although I can tell you from experience, I've been to meetings where an owner wanted to vote 1.5 votes for one person and a half vote. You have to use whole numbers when you do this. You know, it gets really complicated. Particularly when you have an association with 34 different types of percentage of common interest, it can really be a bear to do that. So you go into the voting, and certainly the people who either are there in person to vote or have a proxy get the vote, right? And for the election of directors, it's going to be the majority basically wins, and if there's a tie somehow, then there's going to be another ballot to maybe it's eliminated one of the people, not particularly in your example, but in the whole thing. What other things do you vote on at the annual meeting?
There could be simple things. Let's say you had money left over from your budget at the end of the year. You would normally do what is called an IRS rollover to roll that money into the next fiscal or calendar year that the association operates under so that they don't have to pay taxes on it. You are a nonprofit organization. Might be voting on who to hire as the auditor for the association, or maybe there's a bylaw amendment that's going to be put forth that would be taken as a vote as well.
Because in general terms, the IRS tax rollover resolution comes back from a situation, I think it goes back in the 50s, where you collected money, and certainly some of the money you collect is reserves for like a future roof. Mm-hmm. That back in the late 50s, the IRS filed a lawsuit trying to claim that that was excess cash, it was taxable. And what was ruled at the end of the day, or however that turned out in the end, is that if the assembly, meaning the owners, votes to roll that over for a future year's use, it becomes non-taxable. And I've never seen that resolution defeated.
Nor have I.
And I don't think I've ever seen a no vote on it, except for maybe somebody who didn't understand it. But that's kind of almost every condominium every year does the tax rollover. And some bylaws will provide a position where you have to either approve the managing agent's contract or select the auditor and those types of things. But then comes up the issue of amending. Well, let me give you, before I go to this, Let's just say I'm an owner and I'm sitting in a meeting. I make a motion. I move that the board of directors be prohibited from raising the maintenance fees this year.
And if that motion comes up, everyone's going to vote in favor of it, of course.
Probably. is that legal?
It's not legal in the fact that you cannot make a motion that restricts the board or the association from doing what it is required to do both under statute and the bylaws.
Right. Most people look at it as an amendment to the bylaws because the bylaws say the board has this authority. And by you saying, I'm limiting your authority, that it's an amendment to the bylaws and therefore it's out of order. However, let me reverse the motion a little bit. I move that the board be advised by the owners present at this meeting, we would like you to try everything in your power not to raise the maintenance fees this year. Is that legal?
Yeah, that's not, well, what it is sort of like a resolution that this is what you're going to try your best to do over the next year is not raise maintenance fees, but it doesn't tell you you can't.
Right. It's advisory and non-binding,
yes,
is what it is.
Yeah.
And I think that's an important thing because I see all the time at meetings, not that example because everybody knows that's far-fetched. The owners want to make a motion to force the board to do something,
mm-hmm,
where in fact it either is a board decision or may even be contrary to the law,
yep,
so you couldn't vote on it. So,
well, you have to understand what's in the statute and what's in your own governing documents as well.
And these other motions, which are usually the appointment of the managing agent's contract and the auditor, doesn't appear in all bylaws. It appears in some, but whatever it is, you would need to do. And now we get to my favorite, which is amending the governing documents.
Mm-hmm.
So at a meeting of the owners, you could amend the governing documents.
Yes, you could.
And if the board had a bylaw amendment to proffer to the owners, can they do that or do they have to give notice?
They have to give notice if they're going to make a change to the bylaw, and they'd probably go out with the proxy notice and everything explaining what the bylaw change is so that everybody understands it when they come to vote on it, either by ballot or raising hands at the meeting or yay or nay, whatever the case may be, as long as it's the proper percentage.
Right. And so let's just say an owner who's not on the board says, I want to make a motion, and they have a very clear effort written out. One I've actually seen, I'd like to amend the bylaws and strike the authority to vote cumulative voting.
Yeah.
Is that a legal motion made by an owner?
It is, because it is the owner's meeting and motions can come from the floor. Just like even in the voting for directors, three people have volunteered to run for director, you could still have somebody nominated from the floor to be added to that list. An owner making a motion to amend the bylaws a certain way at the meeting does not require notice, but with the board doing it, it does require notice.
The statute says the board has to give notice to the owners that are proposed by law and the reason why they're recommending it, but doesn't prohibit an owner at a meeting from making their own motion.
Mm-hmm.
He'll either have the 65, 67%.
Yeah,
for 514B, it's 65 for 514A, but they will either have the requisite percentage of the people in attendance or not. And one of the things that people have to understand, owners have to understand, is that this meeting of the owners is a lawful meeting and things can happen. And when you give someone their proxy, you're trusting in their judgment to either vote for or against whatever comes up at the meeting. And frankly, it very rarely comes up by law and declaration amendments that the board hasn't noticed, they haven't gone through something. But to tell you I haven't seen it would not be true, because I know an association that hated cumulative voting, and they knew all the owners hated cumulative voting except for the one guy who got elected every time by
cumulative voting.
And so they planned on their own to go to the meeting and an owner on his own to plan this motion to do away with cumulative voting, which was adopted like 80 or 90% to 10 or whatever,
mm-hmm,
it was, and it got adopted and went through, I don't want to say litigation, but some kind of mediation, whatever, which resolved that, yes, the owners can do that. And
which is, again, another, you know, the statute says you'll run your meetings by parliamentary procedure. And that's why I think, especially when you're having a large group, maybe you have 100, 200 or more at that annual meeting, to have a parliamentarian or somebody who is very familiar with parliamentary procedures helping and assisting that meeting run, because they know how the motions are supposed to be made and what to do.
Yeah. And a lot of time in this proxy solicitation process, owners will call the management company and say, I want to see all the proxies before the meeting. Who's giving who what? Yeah. Can they see that?
That's a good question. Can they?
No. They can't.
Because I've actually had people call me before and say, I want to see who has that proxy.
Well, what they can do is see the proxies that are given to them. Mm-hmm. So if four or five people gave them a proxy, they can say, these four or five people gave you a proxy. So if they're looking for others, they could be calling that person and say, did you send it? Realizing that some people just brush them off and say, okay. Mm-hmm. They have no intention of giving them the proxy. But the statute does provide that after the meeting, owners for 30 days have the right to inspect the proxies, inspect the tabulation, which would mean the calculation of who won or lost, and inspect the actual ballots themselves, which still maintains the secret ballot provision because most of these ballots don't have any identifying factor on the whole thing. Another question. So at the meeting, I should give you a test. I should have done a test here for some kind of prize or something on this.
Number two pencil and go at it.
That's right. So owners at the meeting say, I want to know how many proxies the board has before the meeting and before the voting. Do they have an obligation to disclose that?
Yeah, I think it would be up to the board whether they wanted to disclose that or not.
Well, it's up to the board, but factually speaking, no, because it violates the secret ballot provision that the board has a right to vote its representation, just like the owners with proxies don't have to disclose it. Yeah. In theory, the board doesn't have to say what percentage of proxies they have before the vote.
And the vote is secret, so like you mentioned, most people don't have their name on it, but it could be based on a percentage ownership. Of course, that's what your vote is going to be. And actually, somebody would have to do a hell of a lot of work to figure out how many owned in this percentage ownership, how many sent in proxies, to try to figure out who those proxies belong to. And in the long run, it's not worth it.
And because we only have 1 minute left, I just want to add one thing, so I'm not going to ask the question. I'm going to give you the answer.
Oh, good. Multiple choice.
Help me with that. Say, what is the answer?
What is the answer, Richard?
Okay. Sometimes people miscalculate the votes, and they're afterwards they find out the vote wasn't added correctly. The board can't change the vote that was announced at the annual meeting. If, in fact, they have found an error, the board will have to notice a special meeting for the purposes of having a recount.
Yep.
And it has to be done within, I think it's, don't hold me to this, but I think it's within 90 days of the meeting.
I believe you're correct.
And with respect to that, so the board just can't change it. They would actually have to call a meeting of the homeowners, and they would have to have the homeowners vote to have a recount.
Yep.
And I've been to meetings where they voted not to have the recount, which means you're stuck with the original amount of who was elected. So,
And I think in the long run, even if they did a recount, it probably wouldn't affect a change, really.
Well, there's a lot of stories to that, but we're down to our last minute on a very exciting topic. You and I could spend days discussing this, but they only give me 28 minutes for a show. So I'm going to thank Scott Shirley for being here today.
Oh, thanks for having me again.
Yeah, and thank all of you for watching Condo Insider. We'll be back with more annual meeting and special meeting tips in the future. We just got on the surface of this topic, but thank you for watching Condo Insider.
Ba-dum-bum.